Hello everyone, good morning, good afternoon, and welcome to our Maximize Efficiency in Label Printing with Phoenix. We are having a good number of people already connected. That's wonderful. Okay, so you will see by default your mic is on mute. We are just going to run a quick poll to make sure that everybody can hear us and can see us. So if you can just answer, can you hear us well? Can you see us? Okay, yes, confirmed. Okay. Okay, so I would like to thank you all for taking your time and joining this session. John and I are hoping to walk you through a great Phoenix experience today, demonstrating a piece of artificial intelligence software. And we believe that could help you to be more efficient with your daily processes. You may be new Phoenix from the past. We were working already in label for sheet fed applications. The release that you will see today is the last one we presented at Drupa, where we embedded new functionalities, new features, and especially the possibility to run on web fed labels machine as well. So John and I, we are part of the Phoenix EMEA team, and we are dedicated to our market's needs and focusing on sustainability as well, and Industry 5.0 demand. Sustainability was one of the main topics we also at Drupa, and we can support with Phoenix also in that direction. I'm Business Development Manager for Europe and Asia Pacific. And John, he is the master, the ninja, that will walk you through the software demonstration today. So feel free to post any queries you may have. You will see here on the bottom right the question area. We will try to answer to all your questions on the fly. We also have a session at the end of this demonstration, and if we cannot during the webinar, we will come back to you offline. So said that, John, please, the stage is yours.
So over to the ninja, Matteo.
Please.
Happy days. So hello everybody, and heartfelt welcome to our session. As Matteo mentioned, we've got 30 minutes to cover real fed labels and a couple of presentations, so we will go at a fair rate, but of course we'll share the recording with you at the end. And as Matteo said, we really appreciate any questions or suggestions for future webinars that you'd be interested in seeing. We totally do that. I mean, after the session we did on Tuesday, we actually have now reacting to that and are going to make some webinars based on those, so they are useful and they are appreciated. Thank you. So let's talk about Phoenix initially. But initially designed, delivered in 2012, was released in North America, Canada, and the US. Now in 42 countries, probably more like 48 now, with about 700 licenses, so more like 850 seats installed now worldwide. So we'll update this graph one day, but I guess we'll leave it until we get to 900, right, Matteo? Makes sense.
Thousands.
So you can see that a customer base goes across a whole array of technologies, which you can see on the pie chart on the right hand side, predominantly packaging, but with the latest innovations that we've seen now, we're hoping the label side of the business can increase and grow, and it's definitely an area that we're pushing in as a company. The initial product Phoenix was the owners of the business, the original business before Esco acquired it, were actually part of the development team. So it's a very, very, very technically driven product. and sort of all my sales come second. It delivers what it needs to do, and then we just promote what it does. But it all revolves around this AI technology, award-winning AI technology, which is truly remarkable. Hopefully you'll see it today. The speed that it is able to calculate solutions is beyond anything I've seen before, that's for sure. So the challenge, why are we here today? So we live in a world where the amount of SKUs, the amount of orders are increasing, the run lengths are decreasing. So the days of having dedicated jobs and production jobs that are job specific or you know, one product specific are dwindling, and we're getting much more of a sort of a composite manufacturing process. That's where it is. So that composite manufacturing process with multi-lane, multi-product, even when the shapes are the same, is a reality. And so businesses have to deal with that. So ordinarily, you do have some ERPs and MIS systems that can help you in this area to sort of to calculate this lane solution. But of course, they're disconnected from the production process. They're not part of actually manufacturing the job and creating the PDFs for the workflow downstream. They are only working in their own little bubble. They're only doing what they need to do. So in a lot of cases, people are calculating these solutions manually, which means it's taking, you know, high expensive labor resource, normally highly skilled, highly professional production and estimating team. So what we're doing is this software is designed to help them with that process, take away the things to consider, you know, not only, you know, how many lanes you can fit on a product, but can it be spliced? If so, how many times can it be spliced and joined? Different color combinations, spot colors, finishing processes, so on and so forth. All of these things can take time to calculate solutions. And obviously, if they're not done properly, can lead to issues. So Phoenix is exactly what it's designed to do. So the way that it works is that we install Phoenix on your site. Phase one is we basically profile your equipment. So in this particular case would be the RealFed Digital or the RealFed Flexo device would be profiled in the system. So by profiling, we set the minimum and the maximum, what its material constraints are, what types of material go through it, how many units it got, how many, what's the color combinations and inline finishing process. All of those are set up to set the limitations, because obviously you can compare equipment with each other. Second thing we then do is we set it up almost like an ERP stroke MIS system. So we put in an hourly rate, and then we profile it on how long it takes to make ready, the running speed, and so on and so forth. We get that profiled piece of equipment, and when the AI calculates the solution, that gives us the ability to attach a price to it. In addition to that, we also calculate the price of the substrate. So I've manually configured these devices in my system, but they could be connected to your MIS, and the MIS could be populating them with updated data every time you use it. And there'll be more on that a little bit later on after the demonstration. So once we have profiled the equipment, we then import the data. And again, we'll explain later the different ways that you might be able to do that. But we import in the products, the individual items with their attributes. And then basically the system with the AI then calculates very quickly the best method of manufacture on that data automatically, and then gives you the possibility to select the way that you want to work, whether it's the cheapest, whether it's the fastest, or the one that produces least waste. So we're showing you today and focusing very much on RealFed labels today. That's exactly what we're doing. But Phoenix is designed to work across the whole gamut of print production. So large format, commercial, bound work, booklets and so on and so forth, folding cartons, and not just RealFed labels, but sheet-fed labels as well. Okay, so let's see it in action. So I'll bring Phoenix up on screen for you. So let's just bring it up. Okay, so this is Phoenix. Hopefully you'll get more familiar with it as we do the demonstration. And what I'm going to do is introduce a one-up initially, just to work on it. So there's a number of ways you can do it, but the simplest way of doing it is just with drag and drop. I drag and drop the individual item, and you can see it appears up here in the products, and I can drag and drop multiple items on there if that's what I want to do. If I double click on that item, so in here you can see that we've use the PDF. We don't have to use a PDF, but by using a PDF, there's a lot of data that we can extract from that and use. So here you can see the color combinations have come through: black, cyan, magenta, yellow. And in this particular cut, the cut has come through as well. But of course, you could have tooling in there. You could have foils. You could have all those other elements that would help it to decide the correct device to manufacture that job on, and whether that device that it was using had enough resource to deal with the different, say, combinations of foil or whatever it is that we're trying to bring on them. So that all comes in from the PDF. We also get the width and the depth of that individual item coming through. And so we have enough, if we want to start manufacturing the job. So first thing I'm going to do is just basically show you how we can use Phoenix just to create a step and repeat of that individual item. So if I drag one onto a layout, which is linked to a real fed digital device and a real width, and then I can then use our step and repeat tool just to automatically calculate a filled solution for that, so that I can calculate the way that it might work. I can replace, swap them, make them head to foot instead of head to foot and head to head, if that's what I choose to do, or make them foot to foot. I can increase and decrease the space between the individual items. I can even, sort of override how many of these items that I want and say, just reduce them down and then maybe increase the gaps in between them. So I have total control over that step and repeat. And then I've got two choices, really. First choice could be is I could accept that as it is and basically send it out into production. So I could export it as an imposed PDF file into a workflow or a layout JDF. Or if you're using Automation Engine or InFocus Switch or whatever it is, you could drive those particular products automatically from within Phoenix without exporting a PDF. HP as well, we support HP JDF. So we're using a HP RealFed digital device in here. So we'd be looking to interface that directly straight into that device and move it on. We also have the capability in here of exporting reports. So these reports could be a PDF, just basically gives you a report of what it is that you're producing. So they could go with a job bag, but it can also be exported as an XML file or as a JSON. And then that metadata can then be used by your ERP or MIS or whatever you need it to be, to then either produce its own job bag or its own report, based on the data that comes from Phoenix. But what I could do is basically save it as a template into the system. So that means now that I have a cutter, and here you can see here's a cutter that I created earlier on that is useful for that shape. So I've got that cutter, I want to use that. That is the one that I want to try and use again, but I don't want to, I don't want just to do this individual one item. I want to do multiples. So I'll remove this one that we've just used, and I'm going to import more products into the system. So if I just come into here, let's go to the beer labels, and you can see that, and I'll show you the CSV file in a minute, the headers of that CSV file that I've got in here, I've mapped to production fields within Phoenix. So if I hit OK, you can see up here that I've got a beer label that requires 250 of these. I've got a due date on them. It's obviously important. It could be important information, what the max overrun should be on it. I've got other information like the strength, what flavor of beer it is, and whether it's got finishing elements on it as well. All of that can be delivered and can be used as part of the planning process if that's what I wanted to do. And you can see that I've got 30 different beers, all with different elements. So if I just show you that, my beer label CSV file. So here you can see it's just a comma separated file. So with your ERP system or your MIS, you take a list of either the versioned items or the individual SKUs, just export that data and then save it as a CSV file. And then we can use those fields to populate it. So here are my 30 different lines. These are the different quantities. And here you can see the different elements. Here's the PDF file and all that information being delivered into Phoenix. So you can see that we have all of that information in there. So what we can do now is, instead of manually creating a step and repeat, I can come pick a profile, which we'll have a look at in a minute, tell it to consider all 30 beer labels, and then select, we call them things. So in this particular case, the rotary die cutter and the RealFed digital device, those machines that we've profiled. And then in here, the substrate that we're using, the real label, comes in sheets and in reels. Okay, so obviously with the RealFed label, it's only going to consider the reels. So if I just hit run now, you can see that the AI software goes off looking at possible combinations. So let's just leave that. 7 seconds in, we have 625 different possibilities that it's calculated. This is the AI that we were talking about. Truly remarkable. Now, that pool of data that we've got there, I've got some solutions that are better than others. Okay, some, but by better, that's a variable, right? So at the moment, the default better at the moment is by cost. I'm looking for the solution that has the cheapest cost based on that profile information that we've done, the hourly rate, the run speeds, the mate readies of both the printing and the rotary cutting. But I could rearrange that to not the cheapest, but the one that's quickest. They're not necessarily the same, okay, but they could be. Or I could look for a solution that's least wasteful. So in this particular case, you can see that there is a less wasteful solution, okay, which is this ID274. But this one here, ID61, is the one that's the cheapest. So it could, just depends on what floats your boat. And it just depends on, you know, how important that substrate is to you as to the choice that you pick. So if I just double click on this solution. Yeah, go for it, Matt.
Sorry. Thank you. Just two quick question to answer. Do we have to normalize the file to work with Phoenix? No, we don't need to normalize the file. We can work with any kind of PDF. At the moment, we are working with PDF Plus, I believe, with all the metadata. And if Phoenix can cover all Plato functionality, yes, indeed, we can cover that. And on top, we have the artificial intelligence to work with. It works on PC and Mac. And also as a standalone REST API, let's say in the working in the backgrounds, driven by your MIS, so you even don't need to open Phoenix in case you wanna automate the complete process. Sorry, John. Yeah, no just.
Yeah, no problem. No problem at all, Matteo. So if we have a look down here, you can see that it's created 6 repeats of this with varying run lengths to deliver the results that we require. You'll also notice that we appear to have like seriously high waste. So our waste values are very unforgiving. So what they are is, yes, the white space around the outside of the label is considered waste. So it will be showing that as a percentage. It will also be looking at the potential over deliveries. So in this particular scenario, the customer requested 200. I set a maximum overrun of 2,000%. So I said, you can run as many as you like, basically, I don't care, as long as it comes up with an efficient solution. And here you can see that we've delivered 800. So that means that with that 600, it's all considered waste. But of course, we're looking at the project as a whole, not each and every individual item. If we manufactured those independently and individually to each other, that's a lot of mate readies and that's a lot of changeovers and so on and so forth. So an extra few labels has offset against manufacturing them individually. Hopefully that makes sense. So here you can see that it's calculated different repeat lengths for those different labels. So what I want to talk now, so that was traditionally the way that our RealFed label workflow worked, but there's a couple of challenges with that really. So one of them is, you know, I live in an automatic world. I don't really want to be making templates for every job. And I don't want to have a large database of template systems within them. And what I also want to do is right now, this is not considering, you know, how many items are within a reel. It's just calculating the best solution from a printing point of view. It's not really considering the finishing side of it. So what I'm going to show you now is another import. Okay, so if I just take this file, I'm going to import this product in and I'm just going to call this 6 labels, okay, and just hit OK. So in come the 6 labels. Everything on the surface appears to be exactly the same as what we were doing before, but actually the CSV that we've imported is a little different. So if I double click and open this one up here, what you can see is that I still got the quantities, 250, but now what I'm doing is I'm defining how many items that I require in each role. Okay, so yes, I will require 500, but I need the each reel to be 250, and 500 are the longer runs above. You'll also notice in here that I've defined how many across it is, and the space, number around, and the row space in there as well. Okay, so I've included that in there as well. So the difference is that there is not a template down here for that solution, but there is a template generated as a resource within that imported job. So it's, we are dynamically creating the template for this particular job to do it. So if I now calculate that solution again, okay, this just change the profile and then come into here and then basically select all those six items. If I hit run, you can see that it finishes super quick. Down here, you can see I've only got 8 results and it's actually finished after 1 second. It's looked at that template we've created and we've looked at the potential sheets that it could work on and the different possible combinations, and it came up with 8 results and it did it in a second. It's obviously not a massive pool of data. If I grab that one solution that it's come up with, we still have our element here. We still have our run length controlled within here. But actually, if we check out the layout, you can see that we have created, let me just move this up a little bit so we can see it. So we've replated a repeat length of 50 of these particular items. And then what we've then done is we've then done another lane of those items to deliver the quantity. 2 lanes of this item, and then 1 lane here of this one. And again, we have another repeat length of 50. And then we go again, and we have another repeat length of 50 of these items. And then we have another 25 of these 4. And then we're down to splitting it into 2 and 2. So there is, in each individual item that we've got down here, we've got the bundle size or the amount of labels required in the reel. Not only have we defined that, but we've also defined how many splices are acceptable for that particular job. So in other words, how many times are you prepared to join them back up in the finishing process to deliver those results? So one major difference is if I come here into the role, I mean, it looks massive, is that basically instead of just considering the layouts and repeats, it is truly considering the whole project as one continuous reel, one continuous product that you're then delivering downstream to whatever rip and whatever workflow you're trying to produce it. And we have things, we allow spanning, so you're not on the exact length, you can have items running over, all sorts of different clever stuff going on there within that technology. So again, just as you saw with the other ones, we now have the ability to drive whatever workflow downstream that we want to, whatever way we want to try and manufacture it. So let's just pop back a few more slides. So hopefully what I've done there is I've confused you. That's my job. That's what I normally do. So hopefully it was not clear to you who I am within your business. Am I somebody who works in your estimating department? Am I somebody who deals in your production department? Or am I somebody in prepress? The answer to that question is yes. I could be any one of those. One seat of Phoenix can be installed in many locations. And all I would suggest is if that data is used and a solution is calculated in estimating, instead of somebody else starting it again in prepress downstream, they simply open up what's already been done and edit what they've got, carry on using it. So it's very much an estimating, production and prepress tool that overlaps and merges those departments together. It's interesting. They don't think of it as automation, but think of it as integration. Now, instead of doing it, writing it down and then reading it and replicating it, you're just using the same data like a skimming stone as the job's produced to help, hopefully makes things more efficient. We have some pretty great out of the box integration. So you've seen the first one, you've seen me importing data. So any ERP, any MIS that is capable of exporting HTML or CSV or XML, whatever, no problem. We'll consume it, we'll map it, we'll use it so that we can calculate the solution. We can take that a step further. So we have a hot folder automation component that basically has a watched folder that it monitors. And as files arrive in there, it then consumes them and automatically creates job and then delivers imposed content back. Yeah, very, 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 you know, very easy to configure, very simple to configure, and you can apply specific scripting rules that are appropriate to your site, which is basically what this is doing now. What is an acceptable percentage waste value? How often should you do it? What's the minimum amount of files? You set all that up as you go along. Or you could use or see Phoenix running as a service in the background for an MIS. So these two vendors, we have many MIS vendors, but we picked these two because they were demonstrating our product at Drupa. So we thought, well, we'll put those logos up. We could have put 8 or 9. And we did quite a lot of demonstrations for other MIS vendors. So in a lot of cases, you'll see our solution being used almost as a service in an engine in the background. The MIS gathers the data, sends it off to us. We then calculate a solution, deliver it back, and they present that as their own. And that's very much the way we want to work. And we want that total open architecture in there. Or if you've got some clever people, then most sites do. We have a full RESTful API within the system with more than 160 touch points within it, not only delivering projects, not only delivering jobs, but also delivering assets, also delivering, you know, the libraries, everything with bi-directional communication backwards and forwards. So actually, it really could be configured to run totally as a totally as an automated solution within your own environment. Once we've created the solution, what we then want to do is then drive your workflow with it. That whole don't read it and start again, we want to use it. So obviously we can output imposed JDF, we can output user-specific JDF files, imposed PDFs, whatever we want to do. Or we have some pretty funky integrations with all of the ESCO products. So we're proud to be part of this big ESCO family. So we see great integrations with all of our products over there and happy to be part of it. So I've left exactly 2 minutes for questions. Matteo, I hope we've got more than 2 questions.
Yeah, I just interrupted you once this time, so well done, it was good. So yes, we have a couple of questions here, like can we add intelligent marks on the step repeats and especially ink eaters as well? The answer is yes, but I leave it to you.
So the answer is yes, Matteo. Yes. Yeah, we have really great marks control, a whole set of them. So any layout can automatically have whatever marks they require. Sorry, I'm looking at the wrong screen. I'm looking at the little one down there, but I can have a full set of marks down here, including ink eaters and whatever. You can just either drag and drop them on and it adds those whatever marks you need, or you can link the marks to the device that you're using. So we had these registration marks that are specific to the HP device. They're actually linked to the use of that machine, so you can link them to the individual one up, or you can link them to the device, or you can link them to the cutting device, or you can link them to the whole layout. It's entirely up to you and it can be fully automated.
And by talking about HP machines, we have a question here. Can Phoenix consider the Indichrome Plus ink set, meaning like a standard gamut?
So the increased color gamut?
Yeah, OVG, yeah.
Yeah, of course. So basically, Phoenix that's what it's for. You know, if you are going down that route, if that's a choice that you're making to try and use increased gamut, one of the opportunities that gives you is the opportunity to bring actually multiple labels, potentially from different people, different shape labels, different size products, using different so-called special colors. This is exactly what Phoenix is trying to achieve. So yeah, absolutely. Not only does it support it, but there's an argument that is actually what it's designed to do. That's why it's here.
Thank you. And maybe we take the last one. That is also quite interesting. Can Phoenix export JDF to create rotary die cuts and even JDF for inline machines, like DigiLaser for the laser cut as well?
Yeah, so we have a lot of cutter export data that we can do. So the ones that I definitely know is we've obviously digital cutters. We talk directly to them. We're able to produce CF2s or PDFs with keyline attributes on them. I would need to look at the specifics of the device they're talking about. I don't know, Matteo, but I'll be honest, I would be staggered if it didn't,
No, no,
because
no.
it
We
literally
can.
has so many different, it literally has so many different possibilities, right?
Okay. Yes. Fantastic. Thanks. Okay. So time is over for us this webinar. We have some more questions, John. We will tackle afterwards offline. One important information here after the webinar, we will share a space dedicated to you where we are uploading the recording of the session and the presentation that John showed you, plus the file as well that you saw today, and other information about Phoenix. We ran on Tuesday the folding carton webinar, and there was a very good topic that came out about APIs and how we can connect Phoenix via APIs. So we are going to run soon a webinar dedicated to that. If you are interested, please join. It will be a very specific webinar on integration. So with that, I would like to thank you all for your time again, and talk to you soon. And thank you, John, for the great presentation as well. Have a great day. Bye-bye.